Ladies and gents, and welcome to episode 50 of the Controlled Interest Gamecast. Yes, we made it to 50. We talk about video games and everything happening in the industry. I'm joined by Jordan, who you just heard, and Dom. How's it going, Dom?
It's going great.
And Jordan, anything other than the woohoo? 50 episodes. I'm surprised we made it this far, but we did. Nothing special planned. I don't think 50 is a crazy number. I think if we hit 100, when we hit 100, we'll do something special or something. I don't know. We'll figure it out by then. Anyways, speaking of what we've been playing, I've been playing more Hollow Knight. I talked about that game a lot last week, so I don't want to get too much into it. I've been playing more through that. But the thing that's been taking up most of my time, actually, is Ghost Recon Wildlands. We were fortunate enough to get an early code for it for Xbox One. I've been playing through that. Jordan, I guess, will share some thoughts, too, here when he talks about what he's been playing. But I think the game's fantastic. I want to keep it short because we're going to have a review, and we'll probably have a more in-depth discussion when Jordan and I finish the game. But the game's fantastic. The open world is beautiful. It's bigger than I expected. The game's better than I expected. My only issue with it, it's not really an issue for me because I'm not a huge graphics guy, is there's some texture pop-in sometimes, but it's not crazy. I think that's one of the only major flaws of this game, which is huge. And there will probably be some kind of update, hopefully in the future, that fixes that. But it's pretty much the only glaring issue I've seen outside of some like small minor things, you know, preferences for things. I really love that you guys talked about this with Horizon, but you can customize your HUD for the most part. And I like that too. I like how that trend's starting to pop up more and more in games. Game's great. Customizable options, I think, are cool. They're not like Skyrim level, but they're cool. And I'm just having a fun time through that game. So that's pretty much all. That's all that's been taking up my time. So
I would say the texture pop-in is normal for an open world of its size. But yeah, I've noticed the same thing. Loving Ghost Recon Wildlands myself. Really, I played... basically, once we got off the podcast last week, I just played Horizon all weekend. Loving that game. Really fell in love with it. I was even kind of hitting you guys up saying, like, could be my goatee, could even be better than The Witcher. I think I can put that away. It is not better than The Witcher. It's very, very close, even though it does a lot of things that I don't like about The Witcher. It does better. There are other places where The Witcher is a lot stronger in its characters. And it's melee combat, you know, I could go on, but, loving Horizon, I'm definitely going to get back to that, but yeah, after last weekend, Ghost Recon came out, and ever since Tuesday, man, I've just been all over this game. I talked with you guys about how I needed something, that felt kind of like that Metal Gear Solid 5 tactical, you know, that tactical espionage action. Or operations, as it was called in the last game. And this definitely has that feel to it. This definitely feels a lot like Metal Gear Solid 5. Actually, Jerrad, you know you can do the... you can stand, you can crouch, and then you can crawl.
Yep.
In Horizon, it looks and feels really close. Like, the way the character moves actually feels really close to Snake in MGS5. But you can only crouch and you can't crawl, which I kind of don't like. And so this, I was like, man, I hope you can crawl in this game because it'll feel so much like MGS5. And, it really does nail that feel. And then there's stuff, we were talking about the sync, shots before the game. You and I are both playing it alone. But you still have a squad of three AI members with you at all times. And, I really like them. I think they're great. They heal you once per battle when you're down. And then the sync shot, I love this mechanic. It's basically where you can line them up and tell them, all right, you're going to shoot this guy, you're going to shoot that guy, and I'm going to shoot this guy. As soon as I shoot him, you guys shoot your guys. And then you drop them all at once, and it just looks so cool. It's so tactical, so tight. And I love that in that game. The game really does a good job, as I was telling Jerrad. I think it does a great job of bringing in the tactical side of the Ghost Recon franchise into this specific game. So, the open world is not nearly as gorgeous, even on the PS4 Pro, as Horizon, but it is still solid, and the texture pop in, like I said, I think is a normal amount. So, yeah, I'm not paying attention much to the story. It's really just all about the gameplay and then enjoying the open world. And for me, I'm not at the fatigue that a lot of people are at right now. with open worlds where they're just tired of them. I think I can still jump into a game like this or Just Cause 3 that I'm not super interested on the story, but I can really enjoy myself just, you know, crossing stuff off of the list and hitting checkpoints and taking over bases and stuff. So, you know, putting on podcasts in the background and just kind of enjoying this game. Also, I want to mention I really love the drone. Jerrad, you made a good point that it's not overpowered. You have to upgrade it throughout the game, and by then you'll be at the end of the game where the enemies are harder and stuff anyways, and they have jammers and shit. So I think they do a great job of balancing all the tools that they give you, all the tactical options that they give you, and so making it that even from the start of the game you have enough options at your disposal to have a good time and have fun and take out your enemies, but you're not totally overpowered. So totally loving this game. I'll be playing a bunch more of it, and to be honest, I might even be spending more time with the Division because of this game. And I like this game more than the Division, but they're obviously very similar, and so I'll probably be going back to the Division just because of this.
Awesome. I want to ask Dom what he's been playing, but I'm pretty sure the answer is Breath of the Wild. Wild guess there.
Yeah. I couldn't think of a joke in time. Anyway, so I'll point out I did play a couple more hours of Horizon. I think two days ago. It was actually interesting. So sitting on the couch playing Zelda on the Switch, you know, on the Switch handheld, just in front of me, not on the TV. Just I'm gonna throw that out there. And noticed the TV was off. Emily was just sitting on her laptop playing The Sims, and I thought, shit, you know what? I'd have to stop, and I have to turn Horizon back on because it's, you know, it had been almost a half a week or so since I stopped playing, since Zelda came out, right? And I just completely ignored Horizon, so I just forced myself to get back into it. Not regrettably so. That game is, just like Jordan was saying, it's fantastic. But yeah, other than that, I have to have had put in, I think, 20 hours into Breath of the Wild so far in, 6 days? Five and a half days? Yeah. Which is absurd, given my schedule. So, I mean, that just tells you not only a bit about the game itself, but, you know, the Switch is portable. So that's it kind of plays into how good the game is in a way, because I can play, you know, it's accessible in so many different places that, it, you know, Horizon frankly isn't. Horizon is also photorealistic and Zelda is not that. But really quickly, I don't want to get too deep into Zelda because next week I'm going to do a whole topic about it, but I will leave you guys with one quick analogy on what Zelda is. So Zelda is, Breath of the Wild is The Witcher 3 met Dark Souls and they fucked and had a child. And then Far Cry met, we'll say, Ni No
Kuni. Let's call that kid Nails, because that kid would be tough as fucking Nails.
Yep, so you got Nails on one side. On the other side, Far Cry met Ni No Kuni and they had a kid.
And we're going to name that kid No Ni Kuni.
Yep, and then Nails and No Ni Kuni, those two kids, they met and they fucked and they had a kid, and then
which
that
is
kid
called Nailsy Kuni.
And then that kid spent his whole life studying and playing and enjoying every Legend of Zelda game that's ever been created.
Nailsy Kuni.
And then grew up to be an adult and did his own crazy innovative things. And now he is Breath of the Wild. That's all I'm going to say.
I was expecting an analogy, not a road trip.
Oh, that was a trip, I know. That was an adventure.
Yeah. It sounds great. Like, I'm excited to play that game. I'm going to get a Switch this fall for sure. And that's really a game. That and Super Mario Odyssey are the two games I'm looking forward to the most. And I've seen people play it. I still don't want to, like, get spoilers, though I don't know how much I care about Zelda spoilers, to be honest with you, but it's still, if I can avoid them, I'll avoid them, you know, but if it happens, it happens.
There are things that can surprise you that won't, if you know about them, you know, little things, little gameplay things, one of which I'm not even going to say it, because I wish it wasn't spoiled for me, so I'm not going to spoil it for you. You'll probably end up hearing about it anyway, but I'm sure, I think in like every preview, you know, there's they showed this, snowboarding on the shield or whatever. Like, I kind of wish I didn't know that. And then also when it rains, you know, you can't climb as well. I wish I hadn't known that either. But like every preview I saw, you know, kind of spoiled that. And then there's one other thing that IGN's review actually spoiled for me. I'm kind of upset about it. So I think you guys are – I think I'm going to start adopting your guys' policy of media blackout before games I'm really hyped on. You know, games that I'm going to buy anyway, so I don't need to watch all this shit.
The thing that sucks is like – so IGN got the exclusive rights to first on IGN for Mass Effect Andromeda, and they're posting all this stuff. I have not clicked on a single one of those because it's cool that they're getting those. But like you're telling me you're going to show the first 13 minutes of the game. If I got spoiled on the first 13 minutes of Mass Effect 2 – Jordan's played that, like that would have sucked so bad, you know. And so I didn't even touch that. They got to show all of the new Asari girl, I forgot her name, her loyalty mission, the whole loyalty mission. I'm like, I'm not gonna watch that. It's cool that they got the exclusive and everything, and for people that don't watch it, but like, I love Mass Effect. I'm not just going to sit there and watch this stuff that's just going to spoil everything. Like, so,
who is watching that? Because if
people
you're
who probably
getting
aren't
going to
buy the game, people who are
But like, it's my thought is that if you're getting the game, you don't want to be spoiled on that. But if you're not getting the game, you don't give a shit enough about that stuff to watch the video in the first place. But I don't know.
It's also people who can't afford the game maybe, and they're just like, well, I want to. It's the Let's Play community kind of, the people that love watching other people play stuff. So that makes sense. Or some people just like knowing everything before they go in for some reason. There's people like that. So that's pretty much it for everything we've been playing. A nice open world menage a trois between Horizon Zero Dawn, Ghost Recon Wildlands, and Zelda. As far as the news goes, we have some Telltale news, and unfortunately it's not episode 3 of The Walking Dead, A New Frontier.
Which it God should forbid. Be. It's about time.
Yeah. That thing either needs to come out before Mass Effect or a little way after, and I really hope it's before. But anyways,
March?
Yeah, it's for March, so I really hope it hits before Mass Effect. I really hope so.
When they talked about, yeah, we're doing two episodes at once, I was like, oh, God. You guys are not that quick, you know? You're not that fast putting them out.
So the first bit of news here comes by comingsoon.net. First images from Telltale's Guardians of the Galaxy. First images from Telltale's Guardians of the Galaxy have revealed themselves online via Marvel Entertainment and Telltale Games social media accounts. The first of 5 episodes of Marvel's Guardians of the Galaxy Telltale series will premiere digitally in 2017 on consoles, PC, and mobile devices. The article goes on to talk about what the game's expected to be. I just wanted to bring this up because it's cool to see the first screenshots. One interesting thing, this is definitely it's probably not going to be involved in the movies at all, but if you're going timeline-wise, this is definitely skews towards the first movie, not the second one, considering that Groot in the pictures is not baby Groot, and it's pretty much the original crew, you know? It's Gamora, it's Star-Lord, Drax, Rocket Raccoon, and Groot. There's no Mantis, I believe her name is, or anybody like that, so this is definitely skewing towards the first movie. Or it's probably going to be a side story that's going to be involved in anything happening in the actual movies, but I think it looks good. You said, Jordan, it's weird that Telltale has this weird fascination with making everything shiny, which I think all of them look fine except for Drax. I think Drax looks way too matte. Like, looking at all of them in these photos, I think all of them, the shiniest is okay. It works fine with, like, the metals or other stuff, but, like, Drax looks kind of off. It looks, like, way too matte smooth. But I'm excited for this game. Dom, you brought up a comment before we started that this looks like they're like at least better than Batman, and I think it is their best looking game so far from a screenshot aspect.
Yeah, it's just screenshots, yeah. So grain of salt, but
yeah,
promising.
Yeah, and this is probably going to be in their newer engine that they've been working on. And my biggest thing is like this game looks cool. I really hope that you guys have a game that runs properly. Because we've talked about in the past that for some reason Telltale games have a really bad technical problem with people, and it sucks because you guys shouldn't have to deal with that. But yeah, I think this looks cool. Are you guys excited for Guardians of the Galaxy? Well, I know you aren't, Dom, because you haven't even seen the movies, but yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I'll say I am because I love the team, and I think it's really cool that they're becoming such a big thing in just Marvel in general and, you know, pop culture. And I think they're, you know, lovable underdogs. So I'm glad to see them. I'm glad to see them getting this game. But, of course, I'm super excited about what Eidos Montreal's doing, making their own Guardians game. So yeah, but this should be cool. And I was a little surprised when this was first announced, because, you know, you can obviously see where you could do a Batman Telltale game. There's plenty of storytelling beats to be had with Batman, but, you know, Guardians are a little bit more like a fun romp action, good old time. So we'll see how they do, you know, kind of telling a story with an engine where you can't do a whole lot of, it's, you know, it's just not a third person action adventure game. So
yeah, but remember that they also nailed the Borderlands game, because Borderlands is known for being, you know, heavy action and comedy, and that's kind of what Guardians is, and to a lot of people they nailed that Borderlands Telltale game. So
yeah, I'm sure they'll nail it, and they nailed the action in Batman, so I'm sure it'll be fun. But yeah, I'm excited.
Sorry. Are you guys anticipating playing as each of the characters, or do you think they'll just do like a single character you play as?
No, it won't be Star-Lord. It'll be each of the characters. Yeah, they all have their own individual personalities, and they'll have their own tasks to do and stuff like that. Yeah, you'll play as at least four of the characters. I don't know if you'll play as Drax, but you'll definitely have time with each of them, I almost guarantee. I like that they're making... This is kind of like one of the cool things with Marvel being so successful, and what they're doing is this ragtag group of heroes that no one's ever heard of or cared about. They're coming to the forefront, and they're like one of the biggest things in superhero kind of pop culture right now is the Guardians of the Galaxy, which is cool, you know, because you have your mainstays like Batman and Superman and stuff like that. But like, it's cool that Marvel's committing so much effort into making Guardians of the Galaxy a thing, and they're doing it right, which is really cool. So I'm super excited for this as well. I want to get my Walking Dead done first before I even think about Guardians of the Galaxy, though. The second bit of news here comes by way of express.co.uk. Nintendo Switch sales smash expectations, putting Switch price and game fears to rest. The Nintendo Switch sales have already proven to have some of the best the Japanese games giant has ever seen in the Americas, and now more good news has arrived. While there were fears raised by investors regarding the higher-than-expected Nintendo Switch price and small Nintendo Switch games list, it appears that initial sales have not been affected. It's now been confirmed that in North America and Europe, in its first 2 days on sale, the Nintendo Switch surpassed the Wii. And that's not just the United States, it also includes Canada, Mexico, Latin America, and Australia. According to the New York Times, American Nintendo President Reggie Fils-Aimé has revealed that the Nintendo Switch Friday and Saturday sales exceeded first two-day sales in the Americas for any system in Nintendo history. The Nintendo UK has also confirmed that the Switch has sold more units in its launch weekend than the Wii. There was also the added information Zelda Breath of the Wild is now the biggest-selling Nintendo launch title in Europe, which isn't surprising. I think these sales numbers are great. Obviously, this doesn't mean that, you know, Nintendo Switch is going to sell Wii numbers. It's a launch, and we saw with Wii U that a launch can be good and then it can die out, right? But I do think this is promising. One of the big conversations is if Nintendo Switch will succeed or not, because console sales for Nintendo have gone down every time one's released, with the anomaly being the Wii. I think the problem with that argument is people are talking about it as if it's a console, though it is a mobile console hybrid. I think this is a handheld. I think the market sees it as a handheld. I think when we look at it, we see it as a handheld first that can also be played on the television. Am I wrong with that assessment?
Yeah, and we'll get into it with my topic a little later, but long story short, you're absolutely right.
Yeah, and their handhelds sell very well. You know, people make jokes about the 3DS vast library and all these things, but it sold 60+ million units. Like, their handhelds sell. I've owned every Nintendo handheld except for the DS Lite. I love Nintendo's handhelds, and that's why I'm super excited for the Switch, because it is a handheld that's also a console, you know? And I think that people are going to be surprised at how well this sells as a handheld. And I think Nintendo's doing the smart thing of letting the market decide how they're going to see this thing. And once they see people gravitate more towards this being a handheld, I think they'll lend that more towards their marketing strategies. We kind of already see that. In a lot of the Switch trailers, it's always in handheld mode or in portable. There's glimpses of it on a television, but that's not the mainstay, you know? They don't focus on the television. So I'm excited by this. Jordan, what do you think about these sales numbers? Are they surprising? Should people be excited? Should people, wait and see what happens?
I think they're just solid. And obviously, they're not bad at any stretch, but... I think they're definitely solid. I think, it's going to be telling in June and July when it seems like there aren't going to be any games out. It's going to be telling to see how it does around those times. Because of course it's going to sell this fall with Mario, and of course it's going to sell more at launch. But yeah, we'll have to see. I'm more concerned with some of the technical issues that I've seen online. It seems like the build quality of the system isn't super great, which is actually pretty uncharacteristic for Nintendo. They usually make really solid hardware, even if it isn't technically super solid. So I'm a little worried about that, especially for all those kiddos out there wanting to play their Marios and such. But yeah, definitely promising for the future. You know, and Nintendo needed a little pick me up, and this seems good.
I mean, it's a good sign. I mean, it's a good sign, I suppose. I'm probably more even skeptical of this than you guys are. It's like, yeah, that's, you scored the first touchdown in the game. You know, a whole lot more game left and things you have to do before you win, as the Atlanta Falcons taught us.
Yeah. Sports analogies. At least this one wasn't a road trip, Dom.
Go team!
So the next bit of news is kind of twofold. March 8th, we had the official gameplay reveal for Shadow of War. We talked about last week it being revealed to everybody and there being the reveal trailer. Jordan and I are super excited for it. And this is a two-part story. The first part being that the gameplay reveal was awesome. It unveiled that the Nemesis system is awesome, it's new, it's updated, and they added an ally system to it. So not only does the Nemesis system work for your nemesis in the game, the bad guys, you know, the revenge stories, the plot lines, all of that kind of stuff. You also in this game, there's the mechanic of building an army around you with orcs and goblins and trolls and stuff like that. And their experiences with you actually lend themselves towards the Nemesis system. So you can build bonds with these people. And I think that's brilliant. I think it's a really smart way of evolving the technology. The second bit of news here, I want to talk more about the ally Nemesis system with you guys. But the other bit of news here, Xbox is a marketing partner for Middle-Earth Shadow of War, Dev Talks Project Scorpio. It's pretty much there. I don't have to get too much into it, but Aaron Greenberg, WB, and Monolith have announced that Xbox is going to be the marketing partner. So whenever you see a Shadow of War, you know, commercial or trailer, it's going to have Xbox at the end, which I think is huge. It helps Xbox, especially with the launch of Project Scorpio this fall. It's going to be a beautiful game. I'm pretty sure the people at Monolith and WB don't mind having their game shown off with Xbox, right? So I think that's huge. I just want to talk to you guys about both the gameplay reveal, if you saw it, and what this means for Xbox and Shadow of War. So you guys can say whatever you want.
I saw the gameplay reveal. I thought it was great. Good solid 15 minutes of riveting gameplay. And I think it seems like with this game, they're taking a smaller step. You know, not a giant leap. It's not going to just totally evolve the franchise. I don't think. I think it's just going to push it forward and help it progress in the proper way. I think it's going to make a more improved game than Shadow of Mordor, because it was a great game, but it was not an incredible game or breathtaking in any sort of way. It had its flaws, and so I think they're going to be fine-tuning that. But I am super excited to see them bringing over the Nemesis system to the allies. I think, you know, we're going to see a lot of big-scale battles, which is obviously what they were trying to show us yesterday with taking over this giant base. And, you know, you had the Draken, the dragon fighting giant trolls and such. And so I think the scale that they're bringing to this sequel is a lot bigger than Shadow of Mordor. So, like I said, it doesn't seem like a quantum leap in the franchise, but it absolutely seems like they're headed in the right direction, and they're just going to make, you know, be fine-tuning and making everything better. So I'm very excited.
Yeah. Dom, do you have anything about this?
I didn't even watch the gameplay, but Jordan, you're not exactly selling me on it.
Well,
I was kind of hoping for something... Like, oh, it's like a whole new setting, and there's so much more going on.
One of the things in the gameplay trailer that Jordan didn't mention is that they made it a point in the trailer to say there's all of these different environments. They made that a point in the trailer that there's all of these regions that are going
to
be different.
So I need to watch it.
Yeah. Well, they don't definitely show the different regions, but they speak about it and stuff. But the gameplay and the improvements of, like, your interactions with enemies and stuff, it is all of those systems in the first game polished to another level. Like, you should really take the time to watch the gameplay trailer, because it is it is a leap forward for that tech. Like Jordan said, it's not like a grandiose upscale upgrade or anything that like that, but it is a solid improvement on what the first game was.
Definitely.
I'll give it a look, yeah.
Plus, I don't think, you know, I think if someone had played the first game but hadn't seen this gameplay trailer, I think my explanation will probably have them more excited because they already know how great the first game is, but you're not super into the first one, so this stuff, yeah, to be honest, like, since they're just, like, tightening stuff up that was already there, it might not catch you if you didn't enjoy the first one really well.
Yeah. It's not as much of a diversion, of course, than from the first one to justify any different thoughts for the most part. I kind of see where you're coming from there. So that's it for the news. The first topic, I was going to do this last week, but we ended up talking about Game Pass because it was a pretty huge announcement. Video games for the month of March, a lot of them. We had the launch of a new console this month, so there's a lot of games there. I might be missing a couple, but I'm trying to include everything. We don't have to go deep into them. So we'll start off, the Nintendo Switch launched March 3rd. Huge, obviously we've talked about that. I Am Setsuna launched with the console. Obviously it came out before, but it launched on that platform. Snipper Clips came out, which is probably the second best game on the Switch currently. You could possibly make a case for Spectre Knight, the DLC for Shovel Knight, but everyone's loving Snipper Clips. 1-2 Switch, the packing game that's not a packing game. Everyone knows about that game by now, milking the cow and eating sandwiches. The killer app right now, or the only app for Nintendo Switch, Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild, also March 3rd. All of those came out, including Super Bomberman R, which is getting mad reviews, but it seems like if you like Bomberman, it's enough of a Bomberman game to want you to buy it and play it and stuff like that. It's not great, but it is solid for people who love Bomberman. Just Dance also came out if you're interested in that. On the 7th, we had LEGO Worlds. This was actually going to be supposed to be coming out in February. It got delayed, so now it's coming. It came out obviously a couple of days ago from recording. LEGO Worlds, we've talked about that. Ghost Recon Wildlands, Jordan and I have both been playing that. We talked about that as well. Very solid game. A game that I don't think is getting enough attention, but because it's crammed in with all these other games that have come out, it's just fallen to the wayside. Nier Automata.
Yeah, lots of games.
Yeah.
Like that. This For Honor and stuff like that. Games are just getting crushed under the weight.
Yeah.
Of these giant releases.
So Nier Automata seems really cool, but it's funny because I think a lot of people probably plan this to be a time in which they can get their game out, their small indie game, or just not even indie, but their smaller games, and then they realize the flood of games. You know, it's harder to find areas in which you can strike when the iron's hot. So I'm
telling you, man, it's that June, July. Nobody's taking that shit, and it's just ripe.
Yep, I agree. Next up, we have Death Squared. This is this really cool indie game from an Australian developer. It's a co-optional game. If you love Overcooked, you'll love this. Each person controls a box, and you have to work together to solve these puzzles. So if you want to put your marriage or your relationship on the line, definitely look at that game. That comes out March 13th and the 14th. March 18th, Tekken 7. This is huge. People love Tekken. So they recently announced Eddie Gordo, who's one of my favorites. I used to play Tekken all the time as a kid. That's coming out, available everywhere, obviously. March 21st, the biggest release of the month, outside of probably Switch and Breath of the Wild.
Easy.
The biggest of the year.
Mass Effect Andromeda. This is coming out. I'm excited for it. I've talked ad nauseum about how much I love Mass Effect. Jordan has gone into the series recently, so he's stoked for it as well. And Nob's probably looking forward to it too. But I know you're getting it at launch, right, Dom? Because you already have Horizon and Zelda, so it's like another thing on your plate.
See, I mean, that's the thing is, normally if you would have told me, oh, a new brand new Mass Effect game is coming out in March, I'd think, well, of course I'm going to buy that day one. But it happens to be 3 weeks after Horizon and Zelda just came out, so really, I'd have to wait on it. I would not have the time for it right now.
Well, you're,
as much as I want to.
You're the only one out of us three that hits the Venn diagram of all three of those games. Jordan doesn't own a Switch, you know, so he only hits two of those things.
Good point.
I don't own a PS4 or Switch, so I only hit one of those things.
It's just the way it worked out for me. Yeah. It's just not going to happen right now.
Got that pre-order locked in. Got that auto-download switched on. I'm ready to go.
Yeah. Another exclusive that people tend to forget about for PlayStation comes out March 28th, MLB The Show 17. Baseball fans love that game, and, you know, it's...
Because it's the only one.
Yeah, exactly.
Shout out to Sony San Diego holding it down.
This game, the next game on the list, was originally unveiled at the Switch presentation. It's actually on all the other consoles as well. Has Been Heroes looks really interesting. It's this turn-based combat game. I'm actually interested in picking it up, depending on the price point there. It with me playing Fire Emblem Heroes so much, I'm itching for, you know, some type of turn-based strategy or something like that to play. So I might look into it. I'm not too sure. I have a couple of other non-new release games that I'll mention because Jordan basically burned me at the stake last time. I didn't include stuff like this, so wait till the end for those. Snake Pass comes out March 29th. I don't know if you guys are familiar with this game. It's kind of been a buzz game around the industry recently. You play as a snake. It's called Snake Pass. It's a 3D platformer puzzle game. It kind of has the same aesthetic as Yooka-Laylee, so if you're familiar with that. And the way this game came about was really interesting because I don't remember the specific names, but this guy got hired to a company to just mess around in Unity. And he was working on realistic rope physics, and he realized people were telling him, like, oh, your rope physics kind of look like a snake. So he turned it into a snake. He started creating this game around it. His first prototype, people told him that the snake was, like, way too scary looking, like, way too realistic. So he toned it down, made it cartoony, and it started vibing with people. So now this game, Snake Pass, that's coming out March 29th on all the platforms. Depends on what the price point's going to be. I think it could be huge. It looks like a really fun time. It's going to definitely hit that family market, which is great. And the snake physics are really good. The way you move, they say at the beginning it feels unnatural, but you actually have to move like a snake to move that game, like left to right subtly. Like you can't just push forward. So it's really cool. A lot of the puzzles in it that we've seen are really interesting, having to use the snake physics, because that's a thing now in 2017 for video games.
Ooh, them snake physics.
Them snake physics. The last two things, these are definitely Jordan and Dom go-tos. These are not full retail releases of games, but these are things that people are going to be excited for. First off, March 28th, we're getting Dark Souls 3, The Ringed City. This is the last piece of DLC for Dark Souls 3. This is the farewell to the franchise for the time being from From.
Don't talk like that.
Hey, it's facts. I'm just speaking facts.
Hey, don't worry. They're making Bloodborne too.
People, I think, were very indifferent on the first piece of DLC for Dark Souls 3. And because this is the last piece of DLC that we know about, I think that From is going to probably put something together that's really awesome and really cool. And the teasers that we're getting for it look really awesome. So people who are into Dark Souls are probably excited for that. And the other thing that's coming out, Kingdom Hearts HD 1.5 and 2.5 Remix. Oh, yeah. Yes. This is awesome. I wish this was on Xbox One because this is great for people wanting to get Kingdom Hearts 3. It would have been awesome, but...
So, here, let me... Jordan, you'll be happy to answer this question. I played the first Kingdom Hearts long ago. Loved it. Like, loved it. You know what I mean? Didn't... Actually, and then I played the Game Boy Advance one, and that was really good, too, with the cards. That was surprisingly good, actually. Haven't played one since. So this collection comes with, if I'm understanding correctly, the first game, the second game, and anything else?
So it comes with Kingdom Hearts 1 and 2, and then it comes with Birth by Sleep, which is a prequel to the entire series. And then it comes with the cutscenes for Chain of Memories, which is the advanced game that you played. But they put it on PS2, and now they've remastered the cutscenes from that. And then it also has the cutscenes from 358 over 2 days, and it also has the cutscenes from Recoded, which was a DS port of a mobile game back when, like, before iPhones, when it was like, you know, like fucked up mobile games, like playing on.
Frankly, I was hoping. You would just say it's the first and second games, and that's it, and I could just grab it and then just play it and be happy. And
if you're trying to get into Kingdom Hearts, there's no, like, you can't just stick.
You can't half-ass. You're either all or nothing.
Yeah. And that, not only that, you'd have to buy... What you'd have to do is buy this 1.5, 2.5 collection, and then you'd also need 2.8, which came out at the end of January.
See, frankly, that's just not going to happen. I'm just...
See, that's... Yeah, that's what I was trying to say. Now, see, Jerrad, I'm glad you mentioned this because it's, you know, probably the hottest release of the year. I'm so excited that these games are finally going to be on PS4. It does suck that you're not getting it on Xbox One. I'm still not convinced that you're going to see Kingdom Hearts 3 on Xbox One. You might. If you do, I'm happy. But, you know, if you're trying to go through the entire Kingdom Hearts saga and prepare for Kingdom Hearts 3, PlayStation is obviously the place to be. And so, yeah, I'm really excited about this. I've played, you know, all of these games before in some way or another, and really can't wait to replay them. I'm hoping that they give us a subtitle option, which they didn't on PS3 for these collections. Which you're like, why does that matter, Jordan? Shut the fuck up. But it really matters when you're playing these 40-hour RPGs and you can't turn subtitles off. And there's like six of them in this collection. So
the reason I asked, I just saw a commercial for this Beauty and the Beast movie that's coming out. And it reminded me how cool that level was in the first game for Beauty and the Beast. And it just got me thinking, like, wow, I forgot how much I loved Kingdom Hearts. It's just too much of a hurdle to do all that. I was thinking, I don't know, maybe I end up just jumping straight into 3 when it comes out and just trying to find some YouTube video summarizing all the story up till then, if that's even possible.
Yeah, because
there's no way I'm buying all that and playing all those. It's just not going to happen.
There's a lot of lore, and it's a lot of lore that isn't just the Disney lore. It's Kingdom Hearts' own personal lore, so... I love it, and I think a lot of other people love it. That's why people get so into it on the internet. But yeah, unless you're trying to go through about, you know, like 8 games in the next year or so, then this is probably more for people like me who just want to replay all the games before 3 comes out. Because that's the thing is, even people that have played the series, every game as it's come out, all of us like super fans of Kingdom Hearts still need this collection, because there's been so many random releases over the years on different consoles. We need it all in one place. Plus, you know, it's been like 15 years since Kingdom Hearts 2 came out, so it's like we even the biggest fans need to replay these games. So that's why I'm glad to have it. But oh, I wanted to say, Jerrad, I wouldn't have burned you if you had skipped this one, because this one is actually just a re-release of all old games.
The other one was a new game. 2.8
had 2.8 had 0.2 Birth by Sleep, which is brand new.
Yeah. So March was a huge month as far as video games go. One of the biggest things with the month of March was the release of Nintendo Switch, a brand new console. Dom, you spent a week with it, so give us your impressions.
Switch.
So, where should I start? Okay, the point you brought up earlier, Jerrad, and a lot of people seem to be under the impression that Nintendo is marketing this as a console first and then a handheld. I'm not seeing that marketing myself, but maybe I'm just blind to it and I'm not seeing the same commercials. I don't know, because all I'm seeing from them is this is a handheld, and that's the first point that I can't hit hard enough, is like, this is a handheld. It's like, brought it over. All right, so we can get a good view.
Literally, you haven't got any scratches from the dock, have you?
I'm going to get to that. But it's a tablet. Like, it's a small tablet. It's thicker than most, but it's literally a tablet not that much bigger than my phone. So I think what really is going to do it for a lot of people is there's some videos IGN did, you know, comparing it to the size of other consoles. And when it's sitting on top of a PS4 or Xbox One, it's, like, tiny, right? And I think people need to see that, so they're not sitting here like, why doesn't it at least have a 1 terabyte hard drive, and why can't the battery last 10 hours?
Where's the 4K, Dom? That's what I
exactly.
want to know.
I mean, just it's you, if you just look at it and see how small the damn thing is, like, then you realize, okay, I see why they had to make some sacrifices in order to make it so portable, and that's the point, and that's why I can't stress enough that it's a handheld first that just happens to be able to plug in to your TV. And it does so in a really streamlined way. So, for example, I could very much plug my laptop into my TV, and that doesn't make it, you know, a home console all of a sudden. It's still a laptop, a portable machine first, right? And that's obviously not nearly as streamlined as plugging the Switch into the dock to get it on the TV is. But you get my point. So jumping off that, overall, I'll just lay out there first that it's fantastic. But it does have a few shortcomings, but it's still fantastic despite those. So the first, and this is a huge issue, as Jordan alluded to, apparently everyone's docks scratch the screen when you slide it in and out, which is so fundamentally broken.
Completely unacceptable.
Nintendo seems to jump on this because they removed the dock to be able to be purchased from the actual site. So despite all the obviously all the Nintendo Switches that are already produced, it seems like they're going back and having to, you know, work on this. So,
which is good. Yeah, they jumped on it really quickly. I did see that, but it just seems like such a weird oversight. Fundamental thing.
Seems like an oversight.
Right, like that's the core function of this, is to put it in and out of the dock. That's what all your commercials show over and over, is just in and out of the dock. Like, how do you screw that up? So luckily I read about that before using it too much, and I did test it in the dock once just to see how it works on TV, and it is just as seamless as they make it seem. Like, that's no gimmick. Like, it literally does just pop right off. It's on your screen just like that. And but since then, I'm not using the dock until my glass screen protectors get mailed to me. So and that's fine, because I mean, it's fine for me. It's not fine in general, because I've pretty much been playing Zelda portably anyway, because that's just how that game and how it fits in for my lifestyle, I guess, right now. So it's not a huge deal for me right now. Once I get Mario Kart and some other things, I'm going to want to use it on the TV.
Dom, so that's a huge issue. I've heard the kickstand is shitty. Tell me about that.
Yeah, I mean, it's this flimsy little thing, and it's... The bigger problem isn't so much that it's flimsy, but it doesn't go back far enough, if that makes sense. So you kind of got to be level with it. So if you're a really tall person, it's pretty much not going to do shit for you, because you're going to have to bend your neck over so far. Yeah. It's not adjustable in any way, and that's kind of a bummer. And then it's also kind of flimsy, but that's not a huge one for me either.
I don't know if you're going to get into this, but I have a question. I heard that the UI and everything isn't as quirky as Nintendo's UI usually is for their systems. It's a lot more like seamless and, I guess, professional looking. That's a weird way to put it.
Super clean. It's just right to the point. It reminds me a lot. I mean, actually, in the most literal way, it's a lot like PS4, where you have squares, you know, a main bar of squares going across the screen and tiles. Yeah, that's a better word. Yeah, super simple, super nice. It does. It gives you some goofy noises when you click on stuff.
Oh, that's good. I like that. But, yeah, I like that. That's still Nintendo, yeah. So that's good.
They didn't totally abandon their own charm, I guess. So the dock thing, that's an issue, and it's just completely inexcusable. And at least they're jumping on that quickly. So there were apparently a handful of people
absolutely unacceptable.
Yeah,
Harry Potter.
But at least on that issue, they jumped on it, and it seems like they're fixing it. They're getting new docks out there. That's good. A bigger issue is apparently, and like any kind of LCD screen, sometimes, you know, you get dead pixels. And this didn't happen to me, but apparently there's a chunk of people out there who got their brand new Switch units and, you know, have some noticeable dead pixels. And we're kind of told by Nintendo, well, that just happens sometimes, which is true, but they're not going to help you out. Apparently that's not covered under the warranty or something completely
once
obnoxious.
Once again, absolutely unacceptable.
And that one is worse than the dock to me, because the dock is just someone screwed up. This is them being like intentionally assholes. That's just how it comes across.
Dead pixels do happen on malfunctioning screens, which is right, the problem like, there. They're saying that it's not malfunctioning and that they're not going to replace it, but that's exactly what it's doing, and it absolutely needs to be replaced.
I mean, that's the kind of thing where I wouldn't be surprised if they catch a lawsuit soon on something like that, if there's enough people. Maybe it's overblown and it's only a couple people, or maybe it's just one, you know, one rep from Nintendo who said that and shouldn't have. Who knows?
But no, it's on their website. Bad. It's on their website. FAQ.
Oh, man. So that's officially their stance on it. That's not good. That's not good.
No.
I think the only other thing I want to point out, okay, well, a big thing, the battery life is really good. So so every time I've played portably, I mean, it 3 hours is kind of like where I have to plug it back in when playing Zelda. And considering like the scope of that game and everything that's going on, I'm like happy with it. And I never have played it, you know, had the opportunity to play more than 3 hours at a time portably. So that's not really been a limiting factor for me. So,
but is it at like, is it fully drained battery after 3 hours?
Yeah, that's like, well, you got to plug it back in, or you're not going to play anymore.
Like medium brightness?
You know, I'm not even sure. I've not messed with the brightness, but that's so whatever the default brightness is, and with like the Wi-Fi on and stuff. So you could probably make it a little bit better if you turn off, you know, Bluetooth and Wi-Fi and turn the brightness down, I guess. But to that point, what I'm more concerned with is how the battery degrades over time. You know, kind of like after a year, your phone battery just isn't the same as it used to be. That's my biggest concern. Obviously, that remains to be seen how that's going to perform. But
I've never had that issue with my 3DS, and obviously the 3DS is not as powerful as this, so it can't be a perfect one-to-one comparison, but it seems like Nintendo's been pretty good about that, but we'll see. Well, I have a quick question for you, too. So going back to the UI and the systems, with the DS, I love the DS, but how does connecting to Wi-Fi, like how quick is that transition? Because for 3DS, it takes a long time, like it slow loads, right, between screens. And also, how is the eShop? Have you looked at that at all? Is it like, does it run smoothly and stuff like that?
So I'll start with the eShop. I mean, it runs really smoothly. There's 5 damn games in there, so it's one screen, not much to load.
But is it yeah, like the interface is it all uniform to like the home menu too? Is it that clean look?
Yeah, it's got that same look, but like, I'm not even gonna say like if it's organized well or if it's,
because there's nothing annoying, organized, like, yeah.
It's literally like games and, you know, in a tab, and then there's like fucking 5 of them and that's it. Yeah. So I can't really say much about it.
What about the updates? I'm assuming you had like a software update or hardware update, right, when you first booted it up?
Yeah. I think...
Was that quick?
Yeah, I think it took, I don't know, maybe 10 minutes.
Okay.
But I was occupied with something else while it was going on.
So with the download, does it have like a progress bar? Because the way Nintendo handled like downloads for like the 3DS was like the presence for games dropping into the thing. Like, was it just a bar like you're at 80% or whatever?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, it was a bar. And I didn't try, but apparently you can still play while it was doing that update.
Hmm.
But I didn't even try, so I'm not sure.
Last question for me. I don't know if you can do this on PlayStation. I think you can, because it's one of the features of the next gen for Xbox and PlayStation. Can you pop, like, if you're playing Zelda, can you pop out to the main menu and then dive right back in, just like you can for like 3DS and stuff?
Oh yeah,
that's
yeah.
Fine. Okay, there's no problems there. Cool.
Yeah, that's at least modern.
I mean, I think you could do that with Wii U.
Yeah, you can do it with 3DS too. I was just making sure it was still in. With Nintendo, you never know. Screw that up. I just wanted to make sure it's still a feature.
They'll release a new 3DS and not give you a fucking charger. So
yeah, I just wanted to make sure.
Yeah.
I think that's it for questions that I have. I think you've done a pretty good job about it, Jordan. Do you have any questions about it, or?
You haven't had any, any malfunctions or anything?
No, and because you shared like something weird going on and some screens were just blinking out and some crazy shit. But I don't know. Yeah. To me, I'd want to see like bigger numbers, I guess, because it seems like every launch of hardware, you know, you can find some. There, you know, there's going to be a batch that just is fucking just a disaster.
I mean, this is bigger simply because of the dock. You know, it's so
that
widespread.
Yeah, that piece is just ridiculous because it seems like that happens to every dock they ship.
The thing too is if Nintendo Smart. All of these are correctable problems that they can fix for a bit. Like, I think fall and, like, the holiday is going to be huge for them with Mario. I think that's going to be great. And what they need to do is they need to focus on fixing all of these issues. So when that happens, we don't have to hear about any of that stuff. And they are fixable issues. You know, they've shown they've shown that they're working on the dock thing. The stance on the pixels thing is kind of bullshit. But maybe they change their mind or maybe they understand, you know, Nintendo might not know how important that is because it's Nintendo. So hopefully they fix these things. And I really hope they do because I really want to get one this fall and holiday and stuff like that.
I'm trying to buy one pretty soon, but I am a little bit skeptical, to be honest.
The last thing I got to point out, and probably the coolest thing outside of, you know, the obvious portability of it, is the what's the word? How many different ways it works and how seamless it all is.
Versatility?
Versatility. That I don't know why I can't think of that word. it's extremely versatile. So obviously you can put it in and out of the dock. You're playing on the TV. You're playing handheld with the Joy-Cons attached. You know, maybe you're on the couch, you're uncomfortable, and I did this once. Then you just slide the Joy-Cons off, you know, set it up. I mean, set the tablet on your lap and play like with the Joy-Cons separated or in the grip.
Do you have the Pro Controller?
No.
You didn't have an extra $1,000?
Yeah, exactly. But point being, you know, you slide the Joy-Cons off and literally it prompts you to, you know, press each trigger at the same time just to make sure you're, you know, it's the same controllers, synced, I guess. Up. And then it syncs it right back and you're right back into it. Like, it's super seamless when you're switching controllers and configurations, and it just all, like, you know, you don't have to exit the game, or it doesn't take 5 minutes to sync your DualShock, and you got to plug it back in, and now you're in rest mode and all this fucking nonsense. It just, it's super seamless careful. With all that.
When you put on the wrist strap that slides onto the individual Joy-Cons, be very, very careful, because you could do it really easy backwards, and it doesn't even make sense how easy it is, but it gets stuck. So,
and then one last thing, actually, I promise is the last. So back to the versatility of it. One thing I didn't expect to be as nice as it was. So when I did test it on the TV, using each Joy-Con independently as a controller, kind of like a Wii remote and nunchuck, super nice. Like, that's surprisingly good.
Do you have big hands?
Just kind of being probably not. I mean, if you had bigger hands, it's probably not going to work as well.
Yeah.
Because the buttons are small and it's kind of cramped. But just in general, like, being able to put your arms kind of wherever you want and still be able to play, and that was nice. I was surprised.
Like that one scene in the presentation where he sat on the couch and laid down. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
Yeah. There really is something to it. I don't know. It takes a quick adjustment because you're so used to having two hands on it, right? And then last piece, having them in the Joy-Con grip, that's actually pretty good. It feels like a rail controller. There's not really any sacrifices made there. That would work fine if that's what you wanted to do, too.
Now, Dom, clearly the most important question I'm about to ask here. Do your hands ever get cold with all those ice cubes inside the Joy-Con controllers?
Yeah, but then you just shake it, and then you count how many are in there.
Yeah, and you can feel the individual cubes.
Exactly.
One of the coolest developments with Nintendo Switch recently was their Nintendo Direct, their Nindies Direct, where they talked about indie games coming to the Nintendo Switch, which is awesome. And speaking of smaller games, you actually want to do a spotlight this week, Jordan, on Read Only Memories 2064, right?
Oh my god, I'm sorry, but I just heard the scariest sound around me, and there's nobody else in my house right now. I was like, what the fuck is that? And it's the neighbor's dog squeaking on a toy. I was like, Jesus, it was terrifying. It was like,
crisis averted.
And I'm like, who is in my house? Yeah.
So what game did you want to share with us?
After your silky smooth transition that I just blew over like a train wreck. So our indie spotlight for this month is going to be 2064 Read Only Memories, which is, as I've described before, a cyberpunk adventure game where you're, making dialogue choices and solving puzzles and picking up items and such. And of course, I've talked recently about how much I've gotten into the cyberpunk genre, or the subgenre that it is of science fiction, and how I'm hoping to see more games come along with that style, especially now that Deus Ex is clearly not going to happen, since we were talking about Jason Schreier mentioning that they had canceled the sequel at Eidos Montreal. Basically 2064, a lot of people complain about adventure games not understanding how to solve issues or get past checkpoints because it doesn't make any sense, the things that they want you to combine, the items that they want you to use. But I really like how simple this game is. You know, if you need if you're trying to get into this bar and the bouncer stopping you, well, then you reach into your backpack and you grab your ID card. Like, the stuff usually makes sense, the tasks that you're trying to carry out. So I really enjoy that part of it, that it's smooth and it doesn't ever feel like, what the fuck am I supposed to do here? I haven't even had to look up any walkthroughs, so there's that. The soundtrack is absolutely incredible.
I was going to ask about that, because it looks like a game with a good soundtrack.
Oh my gosh, yeah. It's got a really great... basically, I've been getting into this subgenre of music recently called Vaporwave, which is really synth-heavy and really very electronic music that is very cyberpunk. It's like used in cyberpunk, anytime you see cyberpunk videos or anything like that. So
let me stop you. Have you ever seen the movie Grandma's Boy?
I love that movie.
I haven't.
I love that movie.
Okay, well, Jerrad, here's what I just heard, by the way, he described that music. You know, the character with the tall guy, who's the, you know, the famous developer, you know, the real smart guy, when he's just in his own room, then the music that's playing while he's coding.
Yeah. Oh, that's what I
just heard when Jordan described
it. It's basically
that.
Like vaporwave music is like the music from the movie Drive. Have you guys seen Drive? Yeah, so stuff like that, really synth-heavy vaporwave music. I've been listening a bunch to the Read Only Memory soundtrack on YouTube, but I'm only playing like the first bit that I've gotten to in the game. Like I'm not even spoiling myself on the music tracks because I love them that much. So yeah, it's got a great vaporwave soundtrack. The visual aesthetic is really cool. It's kind of got a 16-bit SNES vibe to it. It's got lots of pretty colors because, like I said, it is cyberpunk, and so there's plenty of neon and that type of stuff. It definitely feels like a retro cyberpunk. Like it feels like the game was made in 1995, and the future that they're envisioning feels like a future that would have been envisioned in the 90s, you know, with the robots and the technology that you're seeing. But that's still cool. It's still cool to see like a retro future tech. So yeah. And then, you know, sometimes with this indie spotlight, I kind of like to talk about the indie developer behind it, but really the only thing I know about these guys is that they didn't want people buying this game if they were Trump supporters, which I couldn't care less about. I think is just a whatever kind of statement. They can make that statement if they want to, but I think there's probably plenty of Trump supporters enjoying their game that don't even fucking know that they tweeted that shit out. So it's like kind of stupid, but
it got them an article written about them on most
right pretty much sites, so. Pretty fucking much, and it's getting me to talk about it now. But yeah, I'm still planning, you know, it's not like they said fuck all people who ever supported Trump ever, you know. So
I have a question for you.
I'm sure I'll still buy their next game or whatever.
So I obviously I'm not too familiar with the game outside of the Trump tweet, but I'm looking at it, and these four like main characters that they feature in a lot of their visuals, they look like really interesting characters just from the aesthetic look. Are they that interesting in the game?
Yeah. They are, yeah. The optional dialogue that you get to go through, I was finding myself, you know, clicking on all the options, even though you didn't have to, just so I can find out about these different characters. And that's a great point. You know, I was talking about the aesthetic, and it does have a great aesthetic, but one of the parts of the aesthetic is the aesthetic is the character design, and the character design is really top notch, as you're pointing out there. And I think one of the first characters that you meet is called Turing, who is a little robot boy, and which is, yeah, Turing is a reference to the Turing test, which, you know, is has to do with artificial intelligence, which obviously a lot of cyberpunk is involved in talking about cyber or artificial intelligence. So that was a great little nod. And so yeah, the characters, even him, you know, he's a little robot, but he's so cute and funny that you want to keep talking to him and finding out about him. So yeah, really enjoying this game so far. I fucking love the soundtrack. Oh, also I forgot to mention that the opening starts up, and then there's you know, text on the screen, and this narrator starts talking, and it's Dave Fennoy, the voice of Dave Fennoy.
That's that gives me I really want to play this now. I love Dave Fennoy.
Yeah, cool little shout out right there.
Yeah.
You know, so
this is awesome. It sounds like a great game. It might be a game that I pick up in a lull throughout this year if there ever is any of those. Yeah.
Well, and it was only $20 from the start, so I was like, hell yeah, dude, I'm down.
And if nothing else, I'm gonna listen to some vaporware.
Yeah, some
vaporwave.
Vaporwave, vaporware is.
I like wear better.
That's like
vaporware. Do you know what vaporware is? That is.
Sounds like a company that makes vape pens.
Video game. No, vaporware. Well, that's funny. That would actually make sense. But no, vaporware is like video games that get talked about but never come out. And they're not like canceled games.
Yes.
Well, I guess canceled games would technically be under vaporware, but like Half-Life 3 is vaporware, you know. Or Half-Life 2 Episode 3 is also Vaporwave, because that was supposed to come out. So yeah, but Vaporwave music is also cool if you guys want to check that out. Home is a great artist. I just started listening to him. So that's a good way to kind of get into that subgenre. Home. H-O-M-E.
When I do get around to this game, I'm probably going to pick it up on PC. I hope it eventually comes to Xbox One just so I can get those achievements and stuff. But if not, this is definitely a game I'm putting on my Steam wish list. That way I know what to go to in times of, where we're lacking games to play, which I don't know is going to happen this year. Right. But yeah, it looks really cool. Yeah, so yeah. Thank you for sharing that.
I would say it'll be on Xbox by the end of the year.
Awesome. Excited to hear that. Like with a lot of these indie devs, the way you're talking about this game and what I've seen from it gets me excited for their next project. I hope this does really well, because the evolution of studios is something really cool to see, especially when they make really solid games. Mike Bithell, known for Volume and stuff, said he's close friends with the developers of this game and that they do something special, and that's high praise coming from him because his games are so well made as well. So I'm excited to see what they have in store.
Midboss is that developer.
Yeah,
Midboss.
Which is a cool name, too.
Yeah, cool logo.
So that's it for our topics and news and everything for us. Let's talk about what we're going to be playing. For me, it's pretty much just more Hollow Knight and Ghost Recon Wildlands. There's nothing coming out in the next week or so that I'm interested in getting at release. I might end up picking up Night in the Woods. That's a game I wanted to get at release but just didn't get around to getting. And that game looks really awesome, looks really good. So, but my main focus right now is Ghost Recon Wildlands. Also, today we got the announcement of the release date, the season premiere for Game of Thrones, which I'm excited for, too. It has nothing to do with what I'm going to be playing.
Ooh, but, what is it?
July 16th.
What?
July 16th.
July?
Yeah.
I think there was a actor that came out last week from the show saying it was going to be July, so I already knew it was that month.
Yeah. The teaser for it, you just need to check it out. I don't want to ruin it for you. Just look up the Game of Thrones Season 7 teaser. Has no shots from the show. It's just this really cool CG cinematic thingy. I don't want to ruin it for you. Just check it out when we're done with the show. Yeah, so just Wildlands and Hollow Knight for me, pretty much.
Well, I didn't mention this at the beginning of the show because I was talking so much about Wildlands, but last night, I guess it was Tuesday night, The Americans came back for Season 5. And that show is fucking awesome. It's, if you don't already know, I think I've talked about it before on the show, but it's about KGB agents from Russia in the 80s that are embedded in the United States looking like a regular suburban family, but they're actual, undercover agents for the Russian government. So, very cool show. One of the best on TV by far. And the premiere of season 5 was fucking crazy. That ending was something else. So
I've been borderline on that one. I just haven't taken the shot yet. Is that on Netflix or streaming anywhere at all?
I'm pretty sure it's on one of them. But I can't. I'm pretty sure it's not Netflix. But I could have sworn that I was either on Hulu or Amazon about.
I think
a week
it's
ago
Amazon Prime.
Yeah, I think I saw The Americans on a streaming service, so. Yeah, and then it's an FX show, so FX might just have it on their own stuff. Oh, but, yeah, definitely worth watching. I'd highly recommend it, especially if you like, realistic drama and crime drama and stuff like that. And especially if you like espionage. I'm very into espionage, and so this is right up my alley.
I'm assuming more Wildlands.
So... So, yeah. So, I, of course, will be playing more Wildlands. Like I said, I'm loving that game. That's going to be tied me over real well till Mass Effect. I'm going to be playing more Horizon. And... I think... is it next Friday that Iron Fist comes out on Netflix?
Yeah, sounds about right.
Yeah, so I guess we'll have another show before then. But I'm actually hearing some pretty shitty stuff about that show, which sucks, because I wasn't a big fan of Luke Cage, so I was like, oh, well, Iron Fist will, do the trick for me then, because it was looking more Daredevil-ish, which I like, but, apparently that's not the case, so we'll see. We'll see with the old Iron Fist.
Yeah, so I'm going to keep playing Zelda. Probably for...
Well, you're not playing anything else on your Switch.
Yeah, fair enough. Probably not for the foreseeable April, future.
Until Mario Kart comes out.
Yeah, I'm actually really excited for that. I've never played Mario Kart 8 at all, so...
Damn. I know it's a port. Dude, that's an awesome game you're missing out on.
I know it's a port, and like, yeah, well, the Switch needs new games, but for me, it's like, sweet. No, I couldn't be happier that they brought it over, right? Perfect for you.
Yeah. Get all that DLC and shit, yeah.
Yeah. Otherwise, I'm going to try to get more time into Horizon 2. And on that note, fuck, TV
dude,
shows.
You already have the sequel? Oh, my God.
Horizon, I see what you did. Yeah. I see what you did. You got me. You got me. Horizon also. Anyway, on the note of TV shows, I watched about 5 or 6 episodes of an Amazon exclusive, Sneaky Pete. It's Bryan Cranston and Giovanni Ribisi, if I'm saying that right. I don't know. The guy who's usually kind of a weirdo. Yeah. Anyway, Cranston, anything he is in is pretty much just gold automatically by default. I think he produces it also, but he's basically just a completely ruthless mob boss, and it is just glorious to watch. So I had to point that out.
Wait,
Sneaky Pete.
Bryan Cranston's the mob boss, or the other guy is?
Bryan Cranston.
Okay.
And then Giovanni Ribisi is like scared of his life. I'm not gonna go into it. It's just
Sneaky
pretty cool
Pete. Show. So, you getting the recommendation from Dom?
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Getting Dom stamp already.
Before we close out, I just wanted to say real quick another bit of news that came out before we started recording. It's on video game news. They finally cast Domino in Deadpool 2. It's going to be, you and I are probably familiar with her, Jordan. I don't know if you watched Atlanta, Dom. Van, Earn's girlfriend, Donald Glover's girlfriend, is going to be Domino in Deadpool 2.
Motherfucker. Yeah.
Was that breaking news?
Yeah.
Was that like fresh? Like,
yeah, it came, well, it happened like right before we started recording, so it's like an hour fresh. But yeah, she's a great actress. I like her, so that's awesome.
Yeah, she was great. She's awesome.
Yeah. That's it for episode 50. Thank you guys for listening for this long. We'll catch you guys in episode 51 with more video game news, topics, and all that good stuff. Follow us at CTRLINT. You can follow us individually. I'm at Jerrad_, Dom is at Dom's Oreos, and Jordan is at Mellow Modus. Go to controlledinterest.com for all of our latest content and everything we're doing to keep updated with all that stuff. We'll have a Ghost Recon Wildlands review by me out in the next week or so. And we actually have one of our friends of the show, the other Jordan, working on a review for Spectre Knight. We got a review code from Yacht Club Games, so he's been playing through that. So, yeah, I think that's pretty much it. Any closing words, guys?
Team Rocket's blasting off again!
Oh, God.
Time to switch. Bye.